Welcome to AAU's The Healthy Heart Show with Alicia Lewis Potter. We're so glad that you tuned in this afternoon. This program is being brought to you by the Whitney E. Johnson Foundation, AAU Youth Magazine, and the executive producers, Roger and Shivana Johnson. We also just want to thank our awesome sponsors for making this program happen today. We've got an awesome show lined up for you today. So if you've been following us on Facebook, you've seen that the ladies of the 14-week Journey to Emotional Healing and Wholeness conference call virtual seminar series are with us on set today. I cannot wait for you to hear from them. You know, we've been doing the 14-week Journey to Emotional Healing and Wholeness conference call on the Healthy Heart Show with Alicia Lewis Potter and as well with Empowered Women Ministries to help people move their lives forward to heal from the inside out. It is an offshoot of my book, Woman Will Thou Be Made Whole, and 14 weeks of just walking through the journey and the process of emotional healing. So today we're going to talk to just a few of the speakers from that particular virtual seminar series. And once again, we want to welcome you to the show.
Life is like a big merry-go-round. You're up and then down. Going in circles, trying to get to where you are. Don't ever give up. I'd rather stand tall. Live on my feet. Cause every morning, cause I am a conqueror.
And so welcome back to AAU's The Healthy Heart Show with Alicia Lewis Potter, and that's me. And I am sitting here with these awesome ladies, the speakers of the 14-week Journey to Emotional Healing and Wholeness virtual seminar series. So you may be saying, what in the world is that? Well, it's an offshoot of my book, Woman Will Thou Be Made Whole, back in 2000 and whenever. Long time ago, almost 16 years ago, I went through a divorce. I was pregnant with my second child. My oldest one was only 5 months old, and I was crushed. My life was falling apart, and my self-esteem went right with it. And, you know, I felt very alone. I felt broken. I felt defined by my pain. And so, Woman Will Thou Be Made Whole, after I went through the healing process, Woman Will Thou Be Made Whole, you know, was a book that the Lord allowed me to publish to help other women through the healing journey. It wasn't really just about divorce, as we're going to talk about today, but it was about the fact that I wasn't whole before I entered the marriage. Yeah. Okay, I want to make sure that I wasn't alone on that one, right? And so, I'm just blessed to have brought these women along this journey to help others of you out there that maybe you are broken on the inside because of a past relationship that didn't work out or a marriage that was dissolved. You're a single parent. You're raising children on your own. You've been sexually abused and you don't know how to reconnect. in relationships as a result of that. Maybe you were a victim of domestic violence, and so you're drawn to relationships, or you find yourself to be a magnet for abusive relationships. You know, today we're going to just glean on the wisdom of these awesome ladies. I have here with me Miss Crystal Harris Harmon. She's a nurse, she's a mom, she's awesome.com in my book, and she is the speaker for week 8, which is Finding Yourself and Forgiving You. So, like, I'm not going to go in order. Finding Yourself and Forgiving You. This is Dawn from Atlanta, and Crystal's from Delaware. This is Dawn from Atlanta. She is the speaker for week 2, The Danger, week 3, The Danger, I don't know the weeks of my own journey.
Week two.
The Danger of Filling the Voids,
yes.
Which you have a really powerful story about how you connected, you know, with that. And then Maria Stone, so can I just put this in here? We've been BFFs since 3rd grade.
Whoop, whoop,
say, Mary's in the house. Since 3rd grade, you know, but God allowed us to become saved and get to know who He was, and through that journey, He's birthed purpose in us, and I'm so happy to have her doing ministry with me and really helping change the world. And so she's the speaker for week 5, A Broken Woman Cannot Complete a Man.
Yes.
You'll have to tune in to the virtual seminar series to get the wholeness of that. And then I have Trina. She's from Delaware. Maria's from Boston. Trina's from Delaware, and she is the speaker for week 12, Staying in His Presence. Yes. And so this virtual seminar series is going to kick off again for the second time on April the 19th. You want to mark your calendars. We're going to tell you more a little bit later about how you can tune into that and tap into that awesome resource. But, you know, Crystal, let's start with you. How were you able to connect? Because, you know, we talked offset about that little kind of in-house joke about me not asking you, but telling you that you were going to be a part of this journey.
Pretty much.
You know, and nobody really got to pick which weeks that they wanted. Right. So when you got your topic, how did you connect with that? How did you know that that was it? Like, that's the one you're supposed to speak on?
It actually happened kind of, like you said, you know, just kind of, here, Crystal, here you go. But, you know, when you go through the things that you go through when you're married and you're a mom and, you know, you're a student and you're an employee and you just lose sight of who you are.
Yes.
And so when you become divorced or separated, you then try to figure out who you are again. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm Crystal, but before that I was mom. I was daughter, I was granddaughter, you know, I was wife, first lady, all those things, but I never knew who I was initially after that. So a lot of my recuperation or my getting back to who I was figuring out who Crystal was again.
Wow.
What did Crystal want out of life? What did Crystal want to do? Mm-hmm. And so that's really, the chapter fit very well, thank you. and that's exactly how it happened. Mm-hmm. It was one of those things where, yes, I went through that phase. I had to look in the mirror and figure out who I was again. I no longer was a wife. I was no longer a first lady. I was no longer Mrs. And so those things change who you are.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So I'm proud to say that I know who I am now.
Mm-hmm.
I love me. I do well at what I do. I am a nurse, and I get quite a few thank yous from patients, from my coworkers, and you know, who I am has truly been birthed since my divorce.
Absolutely. Yes. That's powerful. And I want to go back to that a little bit later in the segment. How does a woman, a man, whoever, mostly I think women have this problem with redefining, because we have so many roles in life. How do we redefine ourselves after a divorce or a life crisis, a life change? Dawn, let's go to you. So you have week 2, which is the danger of filling the voids. How were you able to connect with that topic in order to be able to pour out to the listeners when we did that series in October?
It was very easy, and I know that it was God's message to me, because I have been filling voids all my life. And I believe that part of me getting divorced and being married for those 20 years was in part filling a void, because I was abused growing up as a child, so, and it was by my father. And I remember too, I got a little bit older. So mm-hmm. it was always a part of me missing mm-hmm. because mm-hmm. something was stolen from me. Mm-hmm. So it was like I was always chasing after something and looking mm-hmm. for something. Mm-hmm. So I had like maybe 100 boyfriends before I even graduated yeah. from high school. Mm-hmm. I didn't do anything with them, but it was like always the height, the freshness, the newness. Yeah. The exhilaration yeah. from it.
What made you feel, did that come from a feeling of like you had to have someone in your life? I mean, where did that, I know that you said you suffered abuse.
I felt like I needed to connect because I didn't feel like I had any connection. And I used to talk to God and everything, but I still felt like I needed some type of connection with people because I isolated myself so much in my room. Mm-hmm. And could stay in my room for like the whole summer. Mm-hmm. So I felt like there was a void, a black hole in my person that so desperately needed something to be filled. And that went throughout childhood, growing up, and even in my marriage. And I just kept filling with people, places, and things. Even as a minister and different things that I do. And God had to strip me completely mm-hmm. to get to that little hidden place within me
right. yeah.
that was so eager mm-hmm. For Him to be able to completely fill me.
Yeah. That's amazing. Yes. And you talked about really learning a lot about you.
Yes.
Well, I mean, you took the 14-week journey yourself, right?
Yes.
When we did it in 2011. Talk a little bit about how it was for you going through the journey, and then now you're on the other side of the journey.
It was extremely difficult, and I had read your book a couple times beforehand, and right before you asked me, the Lord had led me to start reading your book again. So I'm up here reading it, and then when I had to read it, it was hard, and I was absolutely upset. I really was, because then it took on a whole different nature. It started penetrating some areas of my life that I still needed a breakthrough mm-hmm. in.
Right.
And when we had our homework assignments and everything, I was like...
Oh, yeah, she's talking about the training program.
So yes.
With Empowered Women Ministries, we facilitate the divorce support groups. We have this training program. They have to read the book and do questions about yes. themselves. Not about mm-hmm. others
yes.
because we focus a lot on, you know, you look in the mirror, what's mm-hmm. up with what's going on with you before you can help others. You've got to look in you and mm-hmm. dig deep. So yeah, I remember that experience. She was like, I'm mad.
And the thing is, I didn't mind being pulled on the table about, okay, you're not doing this right, you're not doing that right. But when it comes to my pain, that yeah. was a certain mm-hmm. type of pain within me that I didn't want to share, not even with God, mm-hmm. because I blocked out my abuse until mm-hmm. about 8 years ago when it started to manifest. Mm-hmm. So I started remembering things. However, I would not associate my memories with the actual pain. And mm-hmm. by reading your book, it started releasing mm-hmm. some hidden
yeah.
pain
yeah.
and I cried yeah. about some things that I have never ever cried about mm-hmm. in life
mm-hmm.
so in order to answer those questions, God was like, girl, you're not just going to run through this and answer the questions.
Mm-hmm.
I had to dig deep within yeah. myself and received healing and some deliverance.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think that's so profound, and that leads us to you, Maria. Your chapter, your topic rather, was A Broken Woman Cannot Complete a Man. I happened to be able to listen to all of you do your presentations on that call. They were just mm-hmm. so moving, so powerful. Maria, you and I have known each other for 30 some odd years, but it was in that moment that I never knew how you felt about not having your father in your life
mm-hmm.
and how that affected your relationship behaviors.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk a little bit about how that topic really got to the core of some things, like Dawn said, maybe in you that you didn't really talk about for years?
Well, the interesting thing was when I entered into the kingdom of heaven on earth, when I entered, there was one specific sermon that my bishop now, John M. Borders, had preached, and we hear it all the time. And basically he said God, you know, keeps you from things, you know, seen and unseen. And it was the first time in my life where my perspective of my father not being in my life changed, because he's like, he keeps you from things that are not good for you.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so in my head, I always thought, okay, if my father was in my life, my life would be better. If my father was in my life, things would be different. And I just had this void because I just wanted my daddy. When I grew, as I was growing up in Greece, I wanted, you know, I came to the States in 78. And when I came here, I missed my father. Mm. And it was the brokenness of my parents' relationship that brought me here. But I missed my dad. And my father is Greek. And anybody who knows, you know, Greek people, they're really close-knit, family-oriented people. And it was the I would have people, my maiden name is Staphylopathis, and, you know, everybody looks at this little brown hand, as you remember, and they would say, okay, so where is this last name coming from? But all of this shaped my life, and as I was longing for my father, I didn't realize I had two different longings. I had longing for my physical father, and then I had longing for Abba, for the void that I needed. Mm-hmm. I needed him to fill. Mm-hmm. And so at this point in my life, I was looking and I was searching, you know, the old saying, you know, looking for love in all the wrong places. Mm-hmm. And it was all to try and keep me content, help me feel loved. I didn't feel beautiful enough. I didn't feel, you know, content enough. Everything was, I want my daddy. I need a man. I need a male figure. Mm-hmm. And it was a need, but the need was not just for my physical father, but it was for Abba. That is who I really, really needed, because when I look on earth, there is no father on earth that is like him.
Can others of you relate to that, what she's saying right there? Maybe not in the sense of longing for a natural father, but a longing, and you don't realize that longing is for Abba. Mm-hmm. Does anybody want to kind of chime in on how you connect with that at all?
I can say I connected with that because a lot of times I stayed in my room and talked to God. And believe it or not, my father took us to church on Saturdays or even Sundays. Yeah. So I longed for him, but it was that pain that I didn't remember that I had embedded down in my soul.
Right.
You know, so I was longing for him, and he was longing for me to give him that pain that was embedded deep down, you know, because I was like searching for him in ministry and in my life and everything else. But it was that one little piece I was holding on to that he was longing for me to give to him.
Yeah.
It was like, Lord, I've trusted you with everything else in my life except that one little thing.
Yeah.
If I give you
that's powerful.
And if you don't come through for me on this one little bit, I've given you everything and I don't want to be disappointed again. Because my whole life has been one fiasco after the other.
Yeah, and that's key that you said that, Dawn. I remember in the ninth month of my pregnancy and being as black as your shoes. I don't know if you can see their shoes, but as black as that shoe, complexion-wise, with bitterness. Mm. Like I was so bitter and angry that my skin was dark. And it wasn't just because I was pregnant in the middle of the summer, you know. And I remember just having a really rough patch that particular week. And I felt this vengefulness inside of me. I was getting ready to make a very unwise choice out of emotional unhealthiness, which we talk a lot about that on the journey, how your emotions can cause you to make unhealthy decisions. Yes. But I remember I was getting ready to make an unhealthy decision, a retaliatory decision in that moment, you know.
Right.
And the Lord stopped me.
Yes.
And I remember looking up to the you know, we think we're talking to God, we think he's up there, he's everywhere. But so in my estimation, I'm pointing up there and I'm saying, why did you let this happen to me? And he never answered the question. He asked me a question and that was my answer. He said, how did you get here?
Right.
You know, how did you get here? And so kind of having to, again, me look in the mirror and ascertain what it is in me
that was a magnet for these types of, it wasn't the first unhealthy relationship, it was the first divorce. I think that was the straw that broke the camel's back, because I was looking for marriage to be the answer.
Cure. Right. The cure for
the
cure.
The answer, right? If I just get married, it'll all go away. If I just marry him, I can change whatever I see the red flags and hear the sirens, because I can hear sirens, I can see red flags, but none of that mattered. It'll change after, you know, and we'll talk about that. But, you know, having to just look inside of me and say, okay, you know, I'm the one with an issue. And if I don't deal with this issue and keep putting the band-aid of relationships over unhealthy friendships and toxic relationships and making bad choices, then, you know, I'm not going to be any good for anybody.
Absolutely.
Trina, you had staying in his presence. I know that's far down the ladder of the journey. But talk to us a little bit about, you know, how in your healing process, you know, you were able to connect with that topic.
Yes, absolutely. Being in his presence, I found that's where I learned about myself. I learned all the hurts, the root of it, where it came from. After I got in his presence of being mad, you know, coming in his presence with anger and bitterness and all of that. And if you just be still, just be still, let your heart be still, get it all out, cry it all out, and then just let him, and he'll speak. He speaks in that small, still voice. And it's refreshing to know it's not me. It wasn't my fault. You know, because we take on that it's all my fault. And, you know, some things, you know, we make those bad decisions, like you said. But God knows all things. And he sees ahead. And so, therefore, he has the remedy for everything. And it's his love.
That's powerful.
His unconditional love. And he's saying, you can trust me.
Absolutely.
You might not be able to trust even your mother.
I
identified with the father. Had a father in my household that didn't, seemed like wasn't there. You know, missing the father's love. And he's in the household. You know, it's easy, you know, I think it's easier to deal with those feelings when he's not there. But when he's physically there and you still don't feel the love, you know, you do. You feel it with other stuff. You know, I mean, you get even to the point where you get vain about yourself and, you know, you just get selfish and it's just all about you. But when you get into his presence and you learn how to clean your heart out of everything in his presence, and know that he will love you no matter what. No matter how much you're mad at who hurt you. God will still love you. You know, and he'll fix that heart so good that you can go before that person and be like, God bless you.
But isn't it a process getting there?
Like,
have some of you ever in your journey, I guess this is what I may be getting ahead of myself, but when we were traveling here to be on this set, I in my mind, I was just like, I want to know what it feels like, what you feel that it feels like to be on the other side of pain. You know what I mean?
Yes.
The other side of the pain, where you could look at the scar, like I'm looking for, literally, look. Okay. So I remember that I hit the iron one day and burnt myself, but I can barely see the scar. I can touch it and it doesn't hurt anymore. You know, we can remember what it felt like to be on the side of pain where you looked at other people and you were like, I'll never be happy like that. Or I'll never be this. I'll never be that. Or when is it going to get better? What does it feel like now? Because healing can happen. And that's why we're all sitting here. It's possible. You have to, like you said, make yourself vulnerable to God. You have to, Dawn, like you said, open up and be real with you and where you are. You know, Maria, you have to acknowledge that, you know, there's a longing in every one of us for God. We don't know that that's what it's called because we're so angry at life. We're angry at him or who we don't think he is or whatever. So, Crystal, we'll start with you. Like, what does it feel like to be on the other side of pain? Not that you don't still go through things, but...
Right, and you do still go through things. It's not 100%.
Amen.
You do still go through things. But the fact that you can stand in the mirror and look at yourself and think, Thank you, God.
Yes, indeed.
Because that's initially...
Like, I don't feel that.
Exactly. I don't feel that, but that's who has done all of this. Mm. Yes. That's who has taken your pieces and has put them back together.
Yes.
You know what I mean? And you're not back in that form from before because you're not hurt like that.
Yes.
You're not bitter. You're not angry. Mm. You're not upset. You can look at that person, smile at that person,
yes.
carry on a conversation,
mm. yes.
but no, I don't. Feel that hurt anymore.
Yes.
Mm. Yes.
That's powerful.
Mm.
This is just powerful. We're going to take a break soon. What I do want to say is that you don't want to miss the 14-week journey to emotional healing and wholeness virtual seminar series. That means that you can listen to it from your car, from your home. You can be washing dishes, clanging and clinging and clacking and frying that fish,
yes.
right? Because
okay.
We mute the call. It is interactive, so at the end of the call,
yes.
you can ask the ladies questions. Yes. This is just 4 of them. There are 10 more ladies, you know, and it's a journey that you have to commit to. Healing is a journey
yes.
that you have to A, participate with
yes.
and commit to.
Yes,
right?
Indeed.
Mm-hmm.
Yes,
okay.
indeed.
So you don't want to miss it. You'll be able to tap into it via our conference call line, which is 605-475-4800, access code 234338#. We will make sure that we give you that number again, and then it will air that same week on our Blog Talk radio show, The Healthy Heart Show with Alicia Lewis. Potter, and so you can tap into that resource and really access that emotional freedom that God wants for you.
Yes,
like He wants you free.
Freedom.
He wants you in peace. He
mm-hmm.
wants you happy.
Yes.
Well, He wants you to have joy.
Yes.
Happiness is temporal, but joy is eternal. And that's not something that you can find in people. And so that's why we're doing this journey for you. And we've all had to travel the journey.
Yes.
Some of us started off bitter, angry, like Psycho with the knife in the hand, you know, but,
exactly.
you know, when,
it's
like
true.
She
God.
Said, you give God piece by piece, those broken pieces,
yes,
He
absolutely.
Exchanges it for wholeness.
Yes.
We'll be right back after this. You're watching AAU's The Healthy Heart Show with Alicia Lewis Potter. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Yes.
Got a vision that knows.